How's everyone? Probably not too great because the pressure is really very extreme right now. I feel like one of those mathematicians who spends their life on this really difficult mathematical problem, and finally they solve the problem after, you know, decades and decades of working on this one mathematical problem. That's pretty much a good analogy. So I have been able to solve this central spiritual problem. I've always said here that the continuity problem is the problem. It's the key to success, though, in recognizing that the continuity problem actually is the problem. Having seen all this, and it's a very diabolical trap that we're trapped in right now. Very diabolical trap. And it's getting so bad right now that it can't be fixed. It cannot be fixed right now. So you cannot be a hero. It's impossible to be a hero right now. You can't fix the problem. It has to run its course, and everyone needs to get some perspective on it and then draw from that perspective. Right now, people don't have perspective. And again, the entire issue hinges on the continuity issue entirely. Why? Let me explain it to you here. The fact is that no one's ever been born. Okay. There is no tree, there is no shrub, there is no bush. These are all names that we give to things, arbitrary symbols that we attach and say there's something there, there's a tree there. It's not true. Nothing has a name, actually. There are no names. There are no things, actually. Everything is unnamed. Okay. Everything is actually without any name at all. And it's an amazing feeling when you imagine this, like nothing really has a name at all. So what's really here? What's really here? Nothing's ever been born. No thing has ever been born, actually. We don't know what anything is, because there's only just one thing, as it were. But so none of us have been born. We're not here. We haven't been born. And we can recognize this, actually. We can recognize this is all a training exercise, trying to figure out a way for spirit to become flesh, which is impossible. Which is impossible. But we keep naming, giving names to everything, thinking that it's happening, it's already happening. No, it's not true. But in seeing this truth, there's a central truth that nothing has ever happened. Nothing's ever been born. There are no names at all. And what happens is you think, oh my gosh, and it's never going to happen. You say, oh, I got to set this down. I'm finished with it right now. All of it. No use for it. I got no use for it. I can see that it was all just a waste of time. So let's set it down. And say, okay. And you start to set it down and you say, well, wait a minute. this is all I know. This is all I've been used to. This constitutes my entire experiencing. I can't set it down. I mean, what would happen if I set it down? I might not know how to function. And suddenly you get the jitters. That's called the continuity problem. And then you say, wait a minute. Whoa, I can't set this down. No way. So then you say, I have to value all of this. I have to embrace it. I have to grab a hold of it. I can't set it down. I've got to do the opposite. I've got to grab a hold of it. I've got to make more names. Name this. You know, I am this. This is my name. Everything has a name. I'm going to say that, make up all these fantasies about how this is all some great process of evolution, and where spirit is becoming one with flesh, and we're joining together. It's going to create a synthesis and a metanoia into some, you know, dialectic new. Product of a dialectic and some new creation, and we just go on and 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 on, making up all this stuff out of fear of the continuity problem. You say, but I don't, out of basically saying, I don't dare set it down, therefore I don't dare recognize that nothing has ever happened. I don't dare recognize that, even though it's right there, we can see it. So we do massive defenses against this. So fear of the continuity issue gives rise to massive defenses to not recognize that nothing's ever been born. There are no names. No one's ever, you know, been here. Nothing's happened. massive defenses against that. We create all these storylines, narratives, all symbolic, all imaginary. So we feel trapped by all this stuff we've invented. And yet we're too afraid to recognize that nothing's ever happened, because we think with the continuity problem, we want to set it down, meaning we feel terror, like we'll be disoriented. What do we do? We're trapped by this. And that is why God created the Holy Spirit, to solve the continuity problem for us. Now, once we begin to see that the continuity problem can be solved and the Holy Spirit solves it, we begin to lose our fear of recognizing that no one's ever been born, nothing has ever happened, nothing has any names, there are no names to anything. When you look up at a tree, does the tree really have a name? Is that really a tree? Who said it's a tree? I mean, does the tree itself have a name? Tree. The walnut tree, we say, there's a walnut tree. Does the tree actually have a name, walnut tree? Is that what it really is? No, nothing has a name like that. Does a dog have the name dog? No. Does a human being have the name human being? No. Nothing has a name. There are no names to anything. So we become open to this. It doesn't scare us. In fact, I had this happen today. I had an epiphany. I realized nothing has any name. I said, this is beautiful. This is wonderful. Ah, it feels so. I want to experience this. No nameness. This is great. So as we lose the fear of the continuity problem, then we begin to move in the direction of something that is very liberating. And ultimately what we're going towards, now I want to say this, that since nothing is happening, there's nothing, no names, no nothing, there isn't any real things, there aren't any real things as we think of them. There's only this one thing. And we're it's set up to help train us to believe we can die to what we are, die to spirit. So it's all this, everything is vulnerable, and you see it's getting, you know, corruption is creeping, corruption, death, age is creeping into everything constantly. Okay, but I tell you this, that perception is a fantasy, it's an hallucination. So there isn't any reality to it, which means you don't have to perceive it that way. You can perceive it in a different way. It's like a mirage. Let's say there's a mirage of some sickly decaying foliage or something. It's horrible. And then you decide, you know what? That doesn't really help me solve the continuity problem. Let me see the mirage of some beautiful, lush, perfectly pristine, healthy foliage. And you say, that reminds me of reality. That's great. Very helpful. Both of them are mirages, but one is practical, helps out. So why not see a beautiful mirage instead of an ugly mirage? Why not? The ugly mirage is only there to try to train us how to die to what we are, and the beautiful mirage is there to remind us of what reality is really like. So which one do you want to see? It's a choice, actually. So these are the ABCs of the situation, is that the Holy Spirit presents a mirage, a beautiful mirage to us, where everything we see seems to be pristinely beautiful and uncorrupted. So, I mean, one mirage is just as unreal as another, but it's useful. This is a useful mirage. So it's helpful first to see there aren't any things really. We're simply naming them as things. But if you take away all names, do you see boundaries? Do you see separation? Not really. That's very interesting. And so, you can see just one beautiful thing, as it were. You don't have to go step this tree, that tree, that tree. No. You can see just everything, all as pristinely beautiful. This is called vision, the vision of Christ. It's a new perception. This is what actually resolves the continuity problem, which means we don't have to keep following these narratives that we invent. And we continuously invent narratives, nonstop, just to keep ourselves interested in believing, no, there's something here, something to find, something to get. We're almost here, we're being born, we're entering in, there's a synthesis taking place, and there's a descent of spirit into flesh, and flesh is, you know, all these things we keep constantly concocting these stories. None of it's happening. You can have a symbol you call spirit, and that symbol seems to descend into a symbol you call flesh, and some other symbol come out of that, and you claim, something's happening. No, nothing's happening. Nothing's happening. But all of this is lost on the world right now because the narratives are becoming so gripping everyone so powerfully. And we've lost sight of the fact that the continuity problem is the problem, and the Holy Spirit solves the continuity problem. Without this recognition, you know, the world is doomed, as it were. And when things get too bad, you have to take a step back. And you know, when the wildfire is just raging, the firefighters need to at times step back. It doesn't mean they stop fighting the fire. It's just that when the winds get too intense, the timber is too dry. You could have to pull back and say, let this, you know, this area has got to burn out. It's got to burn out. So burnout is coming on this planet. Burnout is coming. There's no question. There's going to be a burnout coming. Big time burnout coming. And of course, I'm hooked into it. I'm trying to figure out what can I do to help. And it's causing me to burn out, actually. So I'm not good at doing nothing as far as trying to help. I'm not good at that. I'm always thinking, well, I've got to try, you know, my best to do something. But so I probably need to be relocated where I'm just not so, you know, out of sight, out of mind, you know, because it has to burn out. There has to be a burnout take place. This whole situation, then all the narratives being woven together the way they are, the ego is a completely fanatical enemy of the Holy Spirit. I mean, it wants to completely eradicate the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit replaces the ego in us, in our loyalty. It's the cure for the ego. It is the cure for it, because it solves the continuity problem. So we don't need the ego to spin all these narratives for us. We don't need it anymore. So the ego, again, feels incredibly threatened by the Holy Spirit and is doing everything possible to get rid of it. And it will bring God into the picture. That's fine. It's not worried about God. It's worried about the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit solves the continuity problem for us. And that's the key. And the ego knows that's the key. So it will do anything at all to lead us away from the Holy Spirit. And it's done a lot in the world right now, and it's doing more exponentially as we talk. And the world is being led away from the Holy Spirit, even though it's within us. Symbolically, we think we're piling on so many defenses and constantly rehearsing these defenses. Basically, most people spend their time surrounded by those who are stonewalling, who are very adept at stonewalling the Holy Spirit. And they pay attention to those. Those are people who get a lot of attention in the world. The experts at stonewalling the Holy Spirit and providing some alternative narrative of whatever the narrative is. There are so many of them. So many. But it's easy to fix the problem. That problem is saying there's only one narrative. That is the resolution of the continuity problem by the Holy Spirit. That's it. That's all that's needed. But the ego is spinning so much, furiously spinning. Fanatical, absolutely raging fanatic about diverting us away from the Holy Spirit. So this marks the spirit of the time. It's like an incredible conflagration, a wildfire raging out of control through you know, super high winds. And so, of course, the firefighters want to stop it. but they need to pull back and do a strategic fire break somewhere. It's just a matter. It's like fighting a fire. I tell you, this world, coming in this world is like being a firefighter and fighting a huge fire. And you need to do fire breaks, containment areas, and just, you know, there's a town in the way. Go to the town, strategically burn around the town. That's controlled burn around the town. Cut all the lumber down, cut it down, burn it, and contain it. So when the fire gets near the town, there's nothing to burn. Nothing to burn, and the town is saved. That's the idea. So we have to act strategically, actually, given the situation that there is such an incredible inferno right now on this planet. An inferno of defensiveness against turning to the Holy Spirit and its explanation. Because then when you hear the Holy Spirit's explanation, you realize the ego is just a complete fraud. A complete fraud. So ego doesn't want that to happen, of course. So it's super clever at feeding you pseudo-spirituality. Super clever at that. Because it knows you want to believe you're listening to the Holy Spirit. So it serves you pseudo-spirituality. And you kind of feel, oh yeah, okay, this is good enough. But it's really just the ego. And that's been going on forever. Now, this technology that we have in the world, the way that I look at it is really so completely archaic and antiquated as to be quaint and something we should laugh about. Like it's gone. It's like dinosaurs. It's so extinct. It's like as extinct as dinosaurs. Of course, they like love using the motif of dinosaurs and reptiles, etc., in the technology. You know, very apt, right? Because it's how archaic it is, actually. Stuff you would, you know, should be in some natural history museum, you know, these gadgets and things, because it is so utterly passé, and that it's just, you know, silly to even pay attention to it, really. The real technology is the Holy Spirit solving the continuity problem. That's the real software. Okay, that's the real software. It's a perfect software. It's a flawless software. It's a flawless program. And it never crashes. It never has bugs, viruses, malware, anything. It runs perfectly. And this technology that we have is a joke. It's meant as an egoic distraction. We're supposed to be thinking, oh, what do we need the Holy Spirit for? We have all these technology, these gadgets, and that's a funny, hilarious joke. It, you know, this stuff should have be gone the way of the dodo bird. And I call it, you know, planet retard is this planet. You shouldn't call it, that's the name, planet retard is really the name, because only some severe retardation is taking place on this planet, that we're actually interested in this completely archaic technology, you know? That's a fact. That is a fact. Utterly ludicrous. I mean, we're so far beyond that, that again, this stuff should be thought of as the same way we think of the dinosaurs extinct for, you know, hundreds of millions of years. It's so totally archaic. And yet, like, it's like we're obsessed with, you know, digging up the bones of dinosaurs, right? Same thing, we're digging up the bones of this archaic technology. And getting all interested, like, oh, look what we can dig up. Now imagine there's a piano, a beautiful piano, and then a violin. And somebody says, I really want to hear piano. I just love to hear that piano. And then they pick up the violin, and they start playing the violin. And you say, well, what are you doing? I thought you said you wanted to hear the piano. He says, yeah. But I want to learn how to play this violin and make it sound like a piano. Huh? He said, yeah, I'm practicing and I'm trying to figure out a way. And so they keep practicing and you know that, and then others come and they're also doing the same thing. And then finally, you look at all these people and they're all playing violins and they're trying to make it sound like a piano. And you say, hey, why don't you just play the piano? Huh? What's up? They say, oh, no. No, we want to make the violin sound like a piano. See, we can do it. We know how to do it. That's the ego giving them advice. The ego says, "Violin, sound like a piano." So nobody's playing the piano. If you played the piano, it would sound like a piano. Meanwhile, everyone's playing the violin and they're fighting each other over who's making it sound most like the piano. All these wars, these conflicts, all these troubles, just everybody's saying, my violin playing sounds more like a piano. And someone else says, "You're crazy. Mine sounds more like a piano." And then somebody comes along and says, "Hey guys, everybody, why don't you just go play the piano, huh? What's the big deal?" "Oh, no. Can't do that. Continuity problem." So, continuity problem. But really, we're all trying to make a violin sound like a piano here. So of course we struggle. Of course we think that's so difficult. I don't understand. So complicated. You know, I'm a simpleton, actually. Coming out of the closet as a simpleton. Maybe you can too. I'm an extreme simpleton, actually. But I tell you this. The status on this world is defined by what? Having a big mansion, huh? No, it's not. Not at all. In fact, that's low status. Having a big mansion is actually low status, to tell you the truth. What is high status on this planet is to have numerous homes in different places in the world and the ability to travel to them. That's high status. I know people like this. 5 homes, you know, in choice places around the globe, and they, you know, move around, travel. That's status in the world, okay? Now, however, on a larger scale, cosmic scale, for instance, that's not status at all. A much higher status than that is to have numerous dwelling places, numerous worlds where you're welcome. Numerous worlds where you're welcome. Or you and the ability to travel between those worlds. That is a higher status by far, because when you have a number of homes in the world, guess what? Everywhere you go, you're in the same world. So that's a fact. You can't get away from that fact. But if you have numerous worlds that you can go to, now you're getting somewhere, right? In status. But that's not the highest status either, because there are also what's called numerous dimensions, different dimensions. And if you are able to go into different dimensions, not only do you have different worlds in one dimension, but you have multiple dimensions that you have access to. Now you have high status, right? Is that the highest status? No, it's not. Having access to the death-free realm, the death-free dimension, is the highest status within this context of perception. It's the highest status. How do you get this higher status? By being a simpleton. By being a simpleton. Now, in this world, being a simpleton is low status. But in cosmic terms, it's super high status, actually. Because what is a simpleton? A simpleton is simply someone who knows that truth is true and nothing else is true. That's it. They don't need to go any further than that. They simply know that that's all they need to know. That's called a simpleton. That will get you into the death-free realms. The death-free realm. That gets you there. It gets you the highest status. So, again, Jesus said the first will be last and the last will be first. Those in this world who are the most simpletons, the greatest simpletons, actually have the greatest status, in true status. And the ones who are desperately trying to gain status in this world have really, in the bigger picture, the lowest status. And Jesus said, don't lay up your treasures here in this world where everything gets corrupted, okay? It's stupid. Lay it up in, quote-unquote, the world that is to come, which is a way of saying, in the bigger picture, okay, the bigger picture, many dwelling places, many dimensions, and ultimately the death-free realm. So, satsang is striving to bring out your inner simpleton, okay? And I've been able to bring out my inner simpleton to a great extent. And just for example, today I was able to see that nothing has a name. There are no names. Nothing has a name. Simpleton, right? Like, I don't know the name of anything. There's no names anywhere. There are no names. And people say, my gosh, you're such an unbelievable simpleton. You don't even know the names of anything. How incredible. What a simpleton. But that realization, you know, that really moves you up towards the death-free realm, big time. So let us rejoice in our inner simpleton. Simpleton. We are simpletons. Yes, we are. And that is real, real status. High, high, high status. And the more you can see it simple, very simple, keep trying to simplify. And you do that, you become a simpleton. So that's what I've done in my life, is continually refine, make it simpler. Keep doing that. And in doing so, I've then developed this status. I don't know how high my status is, but, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if it's quite high at this point. When you're able to start accepting that nothing has a name, there are no names, you know, that's you're starting to you know, you recognize, hey, I'm up on that ladder, so to speak. Lots of various indications. So the fact is, it's possible that I could have a very high status, actually. But in this world, I don't have any, hardly. I mean, people just think I'm an utter simpleton, and therefore, what if they give the most menial jobs to the simpletons, right? And I'm actually lower than almost everybody in terms of what people think that I can do. But I might be able to get into the death-free realms, actually. That's the highest status. So again, this world has things upside down and backwards to a profound extent. And didn't always used to be that way. It used to be that simpletons were honored. The simpletons become the saints. They're the ones who become the saints on this planet. And of course, the ego is very cleverly getting rid of the saints here and canonizing those who aren't really saints at all. So there's this war against being a simpleton, really. And it's a shame. And we're supposed to be educated, we're supposed to be complex. And there's also this very huge con game being played out by the ego that says that females have the inside track to spirituality and are actually, you know, much more adept than males at it. And because they have this natural, simplistic, simpleton perspective, okay, but this is not true at all. I'll tell you why. On the surface, you might think yes, because why they relate to infants so well, because the maternal instinct is to relate to these simpletons we call infants, right? But the fact is, they're more like a bridge to complexity, because their goal is to turn that lump of clay, so that simpleton, into a very sophisticated, complex, functioning adult that is the opposite of a simpleton. That is their goal, and they're relentless at turning that lump of clay simpleton into some, you know, very, very driven, super successful, super complex adult, as it were. And it's just that they need to start out with the lump of clay and bring it there, but their goal is in the opposite direction of a simpleton, completely opposite. But, and yet, the ego says, oh, look how tender they are to this simpleton child or something. Okay, and you overlook what the agenda really is. So females do not have this simpleton agenda at all. That is absolutely not true. It's one of the gigantic lies in the world right now. That somehow by putting females in charge, that we're all going to reach this wonderful simpleton state, like we'll all be like children. Nothing can be further from the truth. It's the females who are driving their children like crazy, saying, study, 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 study. You know, what is it, the helicopter moms, the Nazi moms, who are just, you know, they want success, success, success. Don't be a simpleton. They're drilling it in their children like drill sergeants. Those are the facts of existence. The ego is just making this stuff up. There's no facts to it at all. It's painting this idealized image that doesn't even exist at all to lead us away from the Holy Spirit, to lead us away from the real simpletons, The real simpletons. The saints, the real simpletons. The ones who have truly accepted just how simple truth is. Truth is so simple, it's beyond simplicity. It just is. There's nothing in opposition to reality at all. So you can't even say that it's simple. But truth is, facts are self-evident. Truth is self-evident. It is entirely simple. There's no confusion at all. Truth is not confused about itself, and there's nothing other than truth. So working toward this being a simpleton is not so easy, the idea that all you have to do is have a relationship with a female, and she's going to lead you to being this wonderful, enlightened simpleton, saying, not true at all. It is not. That is the most bogus thing imaginable. No, you need a relationship with the Holy Spirit. We all do. Male, female, we need a relationship with the Holy Spirit. That is what leads us to being a simpleton. See, the ego is trying to substitute females for the Holy Spirit. And it's been very successful at this time, which was the main problem in the world, really, is we've bought into this notion that we don't need the Holy Spirit. We have women, females. They know how to lead us to the way we're supposed to be, the simpleton that we're supposed to be, because look how they're able to love their children, etc. And again, as I've said, they're relentless, nonstop taskmasters, overlooking nothing about their children almost, guiding them towards complexity, away from being a simpleton. So it's a most inopportune thing to make this claim that the ego has made and to trust in that feminine dynamic to lead us to being simpletons. Now, the ones who should lead are the ones who've listened to the Holy Spirit, male or female. It's not a gender thing exactly, really. It's the ones who have truly listened. Those are the ones, the saints are the ones, but the ego wants to get rid of the culture of saints, the culture of gurus, the culture, and substitute it with this new world order, global bureaucracy, really empowering women to be the ones who are truly in charge, and telling us, hey, don't worry, we got it all fixed, got it all worked out here, you'll all be able to now be these, what you want to be. Not true. You will all end up becoming more and more driven, more and more sophisticated, doing things faster and faster, and some butter. And you have the situation you have now. It's getting worse and worse and worse. Yeah, women are very kind. They're very patient in their objective. They're very patient with the children, saying and drilling names. This is the name of this. This is the name of this. This is the name of this. This is how you spell it. They're very patient at drilling, because they're so intent. It's so important for them to do this. So they're super dedicated at turning that lump of clay into some complex area. And that's not a good thing at all. Not a good thing at all. I remember I had very much conflict with the elementary teachers, the female teachers there, because I said, hey, this is all, what you're doing is completely wrong. Yeah, but they're just like robots, this is what you gotta do. Efficient robots. No, nothing, I said, nothing has a name. I remember that, now this is all arbitrary. Language is arbitrary. Numbers, symbols, you're looking at like numbers somewhere. Those aren't really numbers at all. We're just calling them numbers. They're just, it's just light. We're calling, it's just light. Everything is just light. We're just saying that there's something else there. There's not. There is not. There's nothing else there. It's just a dream. It's a mirage. What is a mirage? Light. It's just a mirage. There's nothing really there at all. And you won't see it as a mirage if you keep thinking there's something there other than a mirage, as it were. So the world is in this horrible situation, not realizing where it's going so well. And right now you can't stop it. You can't be a hero. You can't fix it. It's overwhelming. So it has to burn itself out somehow. And the only heroic thing you can do is leave. Because at the back of everyone's mind, when the ego really clamps down on them and they feel like they're just crushed, they can say one thing. Said, ego, you may have crushed me and you may have crushed all my friends and everybody, but you didn't crush that one that escaped. Remember that one that escaped? You have the last laugh and say, you know what? There's a way to escape, and I know there is. So I'm going to have the last laugh on you, ego. And you know what happens then when you do that? The ego jumps back and says, whoa, wait a minute. let's talk. You know, let's make a deal here. The ego's frightened, very frightened of that. And you say, wow, why is the ego so frightened of that? So, you know, it alarms the ego. So again, as you are being crushed and burned and everything, and the ego's gloating and says, look what I did to you, look what I did to you, ha 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 ha, I tricked you again, you're dying. And you say, you know what, ego, you might have got everyone, but you think you got everyone, but you didn't get everyone. Someone got away, someone's free, escaped you, it's free. So I know there's a way to be free, and I'm going to find out someday what that is, ego, and you're toast. You're the one who's toast, ego, not me. And then you'll find out what happens then. Because that's a whole different story. Suddenly the ego turns into a little bully. And you say, hey, ego, you know, your days of bullying me are coming to an end, actually. I just discovered your weakness. So it's a delayed heroic thing, actually. It's not directly heroic. It's a delayed thing. Because right now people say, why are you leaving? What a quitter. Of course, quitting on the impossible is not quitting. So at first they say, what a quitter. Then later on, when they're really in bad shape, then they'll play that card on the ego and spit in the ego's face. And the ego won't like that at all. And will cause a complete new dynamic to arise, actually. So escaping the problem, sidestepping the problems, is actually a very heroic thing to do. It's a delayed reaction heroic thing. It's super helpful. It's a win-win, because there are those who are determined to go down with the ship, and you have to give them that card. You have to give them that card to play so that they have it. And they can rob the ego of the satisfaction. It's take all the stuff away from it the last second. And the ego will just be fuming mad, you know. It's just like, the whole thing's ruined, the ego will say, And then you can start making, you know, push back on the ego and maybe even be saved, you know. Absolutely, and, you know, start to make a turnaround, actually. That's when the turnaround happens. So again, it's very important to sidestep the problems that are coming. I've got a little info. I mean, it's sketchy. It's very sketchy, but there's a cluster, I think, of dwelling places somewhere, actually, in close proximity to one another, actually. Very beautiful, very pristine. Imagine the Hawaiian Islands before anyone had discovered them, or, you know, like that kind of, but better, better than that. Whole worlds like that. And that's the place to go initially to relocate. I don't think it's just one world. I actually think there's a cluster of worlds that are actually very close to one another. It could be like a big planet, and then, you know, moons going around this big planet or something. Something along those lines, or I'm not sure. But that's a possibility, actually. And each one of these moons that's going around the planet is this, you know, gorgeous, incredibly beautiful, pristine place. And then you're able to travel from one of these moons to the other moons very easily. And then you get used to traveling to different dwelling places and that kind of thing. And so all we have to do is get a shuttle ship to go to these planets. And you do that through being a simpleton. Because the simpleton just sees what's possible, what is true, what the facts are, and nothing else. Nothing else. So actually, being a simpleton, you're incredibly expanded in what you can do, actually. Because you're not conflicted. You don't have doubt. You know what truth is. You accept it as it is. So this is pretty much the narrative that I have been getting. That this world right now is so caught up in the egoic trap and so determined to think that it can win, it can succeed in making the continuity problem go away by just denying it, completely denying that they ever have to return home because they don't need to, because they're going to make this world better than reality. Better than reality. Imagine the folly of such a statement, but that's what the belief is. So they don't have to worry about a continuity problem. So they're really, you know, gearing up for that. And the real reason to put females in charge is because they are very gifted in certain ways. And one of those ways is decorating. Decorating, making beautiful homes. I mean, I was in the tile store. A lot of different stores. Multiple occasions. And you go in a tile store, that's where you find the women, the rich women, and all types of women, but the ones with money a lot. And I mean, they're so completely into it. The tile, you know, just, oh my gosh. And very talented, super, you know, focused on decorating, making their house into a palace. Yeah, absolutely. So they are very good at that. Very gifted at making choices for colors. Interior decorators also. Very gifted at that, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. As is the gay community. Very, very talented at that. Artistically, decoration, textures, you know. You go to like rich enclaves and you know, most of the designers are gay there. They're very talented, and then the artistic community there, they're able to, you know, decorate the homes so they look just, you know, really like, wow, really nice. Okay, that is what is now being supported by the ego. The ego wants decorators, it wants interior decorators, it wants people who are very talented at turning our living space into this incredible microclimate of bliss and paradise, as it were. That's what the ego wants and is supporting, very much so. And also making the body look beautiful, dressing your hair just right, the makeup just right, all the clothes have to be just right, and building the beautiful life here, because again, the ego tells you, you can make this world better than reality, and so you never want to even think about reality going back there. Continuity problem solved, you don't need the Holy Spirit. The ego says, whew, thank you everyone for working on this, you know. Yeah. That's the truth. That's what's going on. And of course, the simpletons are not so talented at that. The simpletons keep it simple. It's not that they're stupid. It's they keep it simple. Okay. It's not that it's ugly. I mean, they're uncouth and no. Keep it simple. It's not the point to make this world better than reality. We don't want to turn it into a pigsty. No. There is some beauty to it, and it's not like we spit on it or something. Keep it very, very, very simple. Basic. Simple. Be a simpleton. Be a simpleton. And you look at like the churches, some of the churches that get this, you look at everything very austere, very simple, and you look at it and say, wow, it's very beautiful. I like the extreme simplicity of the whole thing. You know, it just resonates. But it's not some rundown shack, you know. No, it's just very solid and simple. So we don't really need all this decoration, baroque, whatever decoration. Just let's make it really, you know, groovy and beautiful, and even, you know, like better in reality. Don't need it. In fact, it's counterindicated, really. And they're constantly, you know, dreaming up new textiles, new styles. It's more and more sophisticated, more and more, you know. It's like, wow. That's not where it's at at all. No, that won't get you into the higher realms, the higher dimensions, the paradise worlds, as it were. The death-free realm, it won't get you there, because what you're really trying to do is replace the Holy Spirit. You're listening to the ego that way. Because, and again, the training program of death continues, so you can be miserable, even in your luxurious, well-decorated, incredibly crafted and architectural beauty and all this stuff. You're still like, you're still dying, everything's still dying, you know, and you're not focused where you need to be focused. You're unaware of the dynamic of this continuity problem and what you're doing to try to avoid it. You're not listening to the Holy Spirit. And so you're really getting nowhere. You're getting nowhere, and yet everything is dying around you. Everything is dying. All the impermanence is still happening. So, you know, that's a lose-lose situation. Now we appreciate to some extent, you know, beauty and this stuff, and you know, you don't need to be like overly offended at it. If things are just done like a hotel tastefully, nicely tasteful, everything's, you know, pretty nice. Whatever. It's not a big deal. But it just have this take it or leave it attitude. It's not important. It's not where it's at. That's the attitude that's necessary. You don't need to be iconoclastic fanatic about any of this, about that. No. Just let it be the way it is, but don't be promoting it. Don't be pushing it. Don't you be involved in it? How can I, you know, make it more and better and better? No, turn towards contemplation, the continuity issue, and try to see that central problem that we have. And the necessity for the Holy Spirit to show you a beautiful mirage, and to get to the point where you realize that what you're seeing is simply what you want to see. You see that over there? That's what you're seeing? You don't have to see that. You don't have to see it that way. You can see it in some kind of beautiful, perfect, corruption-free form. Up to us. We're the ones doing the perceiving. What's out there is not forcing us to perceive it that way, the way that we're perceiving it. No, it's not. We just assume it because we named it and said, "Well, this is my perception. This is what I call it, and it's mine." That's clinging to this mirage, so you don't remember that you're not even here in the first place. And set it down because the fear of the continuity issue. That's all it is. But this whole thing has to get going quickly, because for me, I feel a meltdown coming. It must be the global meltdown is coming. There's something coming for sure. Again, I've said before, prior to 9/11 in 2001, about 30 days beforehand, I was struck with a terrible anxiety attacks. And every day they got worse, and I couldn't get rid of them. And I was literally just like sweating fear. I was so scared. And I was just beside myself. I couldn't account why, what's, you know, I couldn't find any reason for it. And then after the event of 9/11, I immediately realized this is what I was afraid of. This is what I was shown 3 years prior. And so when it got near to happening, I got really, really, really terrified. Non-stop jitteriness and anxiety attacks. I couldn't stop them. I'm feeling the same way now. Same kind of very, waking up at 3:30 in the morning, can't get back to sleep. And jitters, constant jitters, fighting against it, and it just doesn't want to seem to go away. So, there's certainly going to be, the Middle East is lurching towards conflagration for sure. You've got now the players are facing off there, and there may be some delays, etc., like that. But there can be instigating things can happen. More and more things can happen to draw everybody into deeper and deeper and deeper and deeperly, enmeshed. Their minds get pulled and pulled into it more and more and more and more and more and more. And eventually, you're too far down that road. It shouldn't even be a central focus. Our focus should be on the Holy Spirit. Everyone's focus should be on the Holy Spirit. I mean, the president should get up every morning and address the country and say, everyone, I just want to remind you that the real purpose for your being here, purpose for my being here, is to focus on the Holy Spirit. And let us make that our central focus for the day. It's not a religious thing. It's not a secular thing. It's a pragmatic thing. It's what has to happen. Because that's the only way we're going to solve all these problems we have, by realizing that none of these problems are happening to us at all. They're not happening to us. Nothing is happening to us. So I'd like to remind everybody in the country, nothing is really happening to us at all. Nothing is happening to this world. Nothing is happening to the universe. Nothing at all has ever happened or ever will happen. And yet we need the Holy Spirit to first show us the world in this beautiful, pristine way, with lovely loveliness. So that will solve the continuity problem for us. And then we can set down this nothing. First see nothing as a beautiful nothing. Flawless, seamless nothing. That's what should be happening. And then this other stuff, but that's what should be happening. That's what needs to be happening. But it's not. And it's not going to happen. So, again, there's not going to be any truly heroic action take place on this planet. That's what I've seen. It's going to burn out. They're going to go through burnout. And that's what I'm feeling. I'm feeling burnout. I'm feeling the burnout that's coming. So, I've got to get away somehow. And it's a constant effort during the day, from three, whenever I wake up in the morning, all day long until late at night, just grinding on this. I'm trying to leave no stone unturned. September, the pivotal month here. Here we are. And much more can be said, but this is enough to digest. It's a full meal right now. And you can at least get the sense, a sense of something, like something, You see, you may say, well, I don't quite get it, and my expectations are something else should be said, and my ideas, prior ideas, aren't these ideas, and I think that I'm used to thinking in a different way, but I do get the sense that there's some sort of freedom here that's being talked about that really seems that it seems like that this is going to, it works, it's true. And you can have that feeling. Like when I'd come across some new teaching and I say, wow, I hadn't heard that before. That's amazing. I hadn't thought of that before. So I don't really, I might think it's right, but I'm not used to it. It's going to take a while to get used to that, yeah? those are the kind of reactions you have. So people won't always agree with what I say, but then they may say, well, yeah, that may be right, but it's not what I'm used to. Yeah, of course, absolutely. That's the whole purpose of the teaching, is to break new territory, new ground, what you have, which has not previously really been looked at to any extent. So then you get the opportunity to begin to relate to it, have a relationship with no and never. That's absolutely key. Have a relationship with no and never. We don't really need relationships between quote-unquote human beings. We need relationship with no and never. Like, no, we can't make this world better in reality, and we never will. Doesn't matter how many interior designers we get, how many architects, how many master builders, how many decorators, how many, you know, musicians, whatever, you know, it's everything. We think all this technology is sophisticated. It's archaic. It's totally archaic, actually. It's so archaic, you'll have a good laugh about it sometime. There's actually, again, this whole domain I call Gadgetland, which I was shown. And I realize everybody there is incredibly retarded. They're obsessed with all these gadgets. Everything's a little gadget. And they think they're like, this is like the best thing ever. And there's not even a flicker of interest in the Holy Spirit there, which is the sign of severe retardation, actually. And what's happened is that those from this gadget land have migrated and come into this planet, and they brought their archaic, you know, eccentricities with them, and they're obsessed with their calculations and their gadgets and all that kind of stuff, and they never give a moment's thought to the Holy Spirit. This is severe retardation, actually. So I call this a world planet retard, actually. That is a much more apt name for it. And so you do have, once this archaicness, like a virus, gets into the world, the world's like been hacked, actually. The world has been hacked. And once this gets into the world, it's curtains for the world, basically, because this virus spreads and pulls everything down with it, and people lose all sight of the Holy Spirit. You know, they're just, because everything is now run by all these gadgets, and it becomes so complex and so complicated that it requires more and more dedication and exclusive focus on gadgets and how they work and how to navigate through this stuff. And you don't have any time at all to think about the Holy Spirit. And everyone has to become super complexarian, and there's no simpletons at all in the planet. Yeah, total fiasco, and it has to burn itself out. It's happened before, where, you know, the triumph of the retards, as it were. Technology that we are totally archaic. No, we have the Holy Spirit. That's the only technology we need. It's what works. It's what works to solve the continuity problem. So, yeah, we don't have to be stupid. We do not have to be retarded, actually. You know, and idiot savants are not smart. They're eccentric and archaic, and they can be obsessed with something that is, you know, has no relevance to solving our true problem at all. So it'd be, you know. So there you go. The situation is that this archaicness, silliness, has gotten into the planet and has, you know, taken it over, basically. It really has. The spread of it is just unbelievable. And if you're not dedicated to it, you really can't navigate through it anymore. It's becoming prohibitively difficult now, and will become even more so, way more so, very, very soon. I just crossed the Golden Gate Bridge, and there's, of course, you can't stop. You can't stop. No stopping. And you have to, I had to prepay online. What did that require? Credit card, sign up, prepay. I have to sign up, I had my information, prepay it, stipulate what dates, and then give the license plate number. You drive through, it takes a picture of your license plate, and then it checks a database, and if you prepaid, and it bills your credit card. That's how you do it. Or you get a fast track thing, which is another online sort of thing. You set up an account online, and you pay the account. It's all done that way. So this is just an example of one of, you know, just, it's tentacles are into everything. And it requires a mindset that is dedicated not only to it now, but in the future. So you literally have to dedicate your life to just navigating through this stuff. It's terrible. It's absolutely terrible. A very, very bad black hole. And we're getting sucked into this black hole of irrelevancy and archaicness. Archaic irrelevancy. And retardation, actually. Those who don't give any thought to the Holy Spirit are retarded. And of course they get very upset about being called retarded, but they are. It's a perfect definition of it. And just because you have gadgets doesn't mean you have to use them, or it doesn't mean you have to use them to distract, you know, from your focus on the Holy Spirit. Like I use this, I've got a simple, you know, $100 video camera, and upload it to the internet. Fine, but I use it to focus on the Holy Spirit. So that's being intelligent. That's being intelligent. And you use your computer. Go to YouTube, watch a video, listen to it on headphones, hopefully. You're being intelligent. You're not letting it rule you. Yeah. So, but your life, your functioning in every walk of life is now being put into that straitjacket of retardation where you have to dedicate your life to, you know, sorting out the complexities, upgrading, apps, upgrading, more and more, you know, involvement. More and more investment in your time, everything. Your house needs to be monitored and regulated, and you have to do it remotely. I mean, the way the house is being built now, there's just so complex, all the wiring, everything is, you know, just being done in all these new ways of regulating, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, to close this off, this video, this satsang off, I had this dream this morning. I dozed off a little bit. And when I dozed off, I was in this half-sleep state. I was wanting to plug something in, the computer maybe, into an electrical outlet. And the electrical outlet was under my desk, and it's back under my desk, and it's dark there. And if I could get under the desk and you look, it's dark. You can't see. So I got under the desk in the dream. I was looking, well, where's the outlet? And then suddenly, a light shone on the outlet. The shadows dissipated, as it were. It wasn't like a light shining, a beam of light. It's just that the area where the electrical sockets were, where I'm going to plug in, the shadows gave way to light there. And I saw, oh, this is where I plug it in. So I plugged it in. And then after I had plugged it in, the shadows came back again. And, you know, it dimmed. And I wasn't able, became darkish again. And then I woke up from my sort of half-sleep state, and I said, oh, wait a minute. This is pretty interesting. How did I do that? And I started thinking about this, and where does light come from in dreams? I did a video on that before. It was more like the shadows receded. I just lightened it up with my imagination. There was no source of light at all. I just lightened it up with my imagination. And I said, oh, wait a minute. And I started thinking about this, a very simple thing. And it led to an amazing understanding of what's going on. Amazing understanding. One of the things the ego is trying to do is use this world to convince us that reality is certain to run out of energy, so to speak, and go dark. And that's why we need to stay and make this planet our home. Because everything on this planet, for instance, uses energy. And we're using it up, right? But in that dream, I asked myself, why did I make the shadows go back? Why didn't I just leave it light? And something told me, says, well, you don't want to use too much energy. Light takes energy. And I said, now wait a minute. In my dream, that receding of the shadows and the light that I saw there, the lightness, is that really taking energy? Why, well, there's no light source. What energy is it taking? Except for mental energy. And is mental energy really energy in terms of non-renewable energy? Is it really? Is it really going to run down? Is that really true? And I found that this earth, the model of scarcity, is to try and convince us that reality is somehow going to eventually fail and run out of energy, so to speak. This model we have here of energy is nothing to do with reality at all. Reality has nothing to do with that. Reality doesn't run on energy. Just like that dream, there was no light source. I simply decided to make it appear as seeable until the shadows receded. Everything in reality is an idea. It's all mind. It's not energy. And this was a mind-blowing insight. Where does the light come from in dreams? See, that is a big, big question. And I caught myself there. I said, why did I put the shadows back there? Oh, to save energy. I said, wait a minute. No energy is being expended. To save energy in a dream. To save energy, I put the light back in the dream to save energy. How odd, right? How very odd. And then I followed that line of reasoning and saw that this world very, very diabolically is training us to believe in scarcity. And we're not even aware of it, that it encroaches on us every second of the day. Scarcity, 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 scarcity. You must ration, you must, it's overwhelming experience here. The feeling of scarcity. And then trying to convince us that we need to learn how to deal with scarcity. We must learn how to ration and regulate and recycle and all these things in order to get into the higher dimensions, in order to get in reality, whatever, heaven. That's absolute nonsense, just the opposite. You have to be a simpleton to get out of there. Realize there's no need for that at all, because these worlds of ideas, these worlds are just held in the mind of the Holy Spirit. There's no such thing as you're losing energy. There's a light source and it's somehow burning up energy. No, it's just a symbol. And you define it as giving light, and then you perceive it as giving light, and there's the perception there, and then you see. It's all done in perception, actually, in the mind. So this world, I'm telling you, this world here is just an absolute hell, really. It's a training program to try and make you figure out how to kill yourself, how to kill reality. Oh, reality's going to run out of energy at some point. It's going to die at some point. So we have this whole world running out of energy, dying. I mean, the planet's dying. We're running out of energy. We're burning it up. And we're trying to teach ourselves this is what's going to happen to reality. See, this world's like an object lesson in what's going to happen to reality. And we're all here saying, oh my God, we're so scarcity. We're not going to have enough. It's all well, it is quote unquote dying here. But the purpose is to draw a parallel between this world and reality. And in fact, there is no parallel at all. Totally bogus. It's really an amazing, amazing thing. So pay attention to your dreams if you can and catch it. Maybe catch it. It's hard to do. I'm telling you, it's very difficult. But you may notice something about your dreams that you just say, wait a minute. It doesn't quite follow there. Something is amiss. How come those shadows went back? What made them go back? Just I pulled away from it and suddenly the shadows just came back. I said, whoa, how's that possible? Where'd the light go? Did I turn the light off? There was no light I turned on. I just wanted there to be to see, and there was light there. And then I said, I don't need to see it anymore, and the light wasn't there. So the light is controlled by my own, what I want. It's not an energy source like the sun or anything like that. No. There's an inner light, as it were. There's an inner light that we have, that we can. And I said, why don't I just see everything as lit up all the time? I said, why don't I just see the whole world as bright with no shadows anywhere? And then this sort of, not a voice, but this notion came to me. Ah, you're wasting energy. You're wasting too much energy. I said, what energy am I wasting? Really? Because the inner light can see light everywhere. It's not an energy. So you see, there are levels. I mean, there are ways to dig into what's going on, and just say, well, wait a minute here. Something is cuckoo with this whole setup of the world. And go back to the continuity problem, because you can't set it down unless you have the answer to the continuity problem. Again, all this stuff that we find out, if something's wrong, the New World Order, you know, everything that's going on in the world, that, you know, you say, ain't it terrible? But go put your attention on the continuity problem. How is that solved? Because the more you see how terrible everything is, the more you want to set it down. And the more fear you have about the continuity issue, it gets you more and more jittery. And you're going to end up with getting in all sorts of trouble, actually, if you don't put the Holy Spirit first, the emphasis on the continuity problem. That is what is being said here. So it's about time to wrap it up. The stress is, you know, just killer stress. I can't seem to let go of it. I'm taking enormous effort to try and maintain it. It's causing me, trouble, not sleeping. It's a desperate struggle, and it looks like a losing struggle at this point, actually, because I see it getting worse and worse and worse. So there needs to be these major breakthroughs, which are happening, but again, they're not fixing the problem here. No, again, the answer is not to fix the problem, not to fix problems. The answer is to realize the problems aren't happening to anyone. That is the answer. Once again, the answer is not to fix problems, it's to recognize the problems aren't happening to anyone. And when you recognize that, you suddenly say, oh, let's set the whole thing down. You got the fear of continuity. So the answer is to get insight into the Holy Spirit, how it solves the continuity problem. That is the key. That is the key. But again, the goal is not to fix problems, it's to realize they're not happening to anyone. Not happening to anyone at all, therefore they're not problems. Aren't any problems. The goal is not to fix problems, to recognize there aren't any problems, because they're not happening to anyone. And then we say, whoops, we got a continuity issue. Ah, Holy Spirit, you're there. Oh, the answer is what? Oh, new perception of this beautiful, gorgeous perception of lovely loveliness. Oh, okay, I can accept that. Continuity problem solved. Set down the whole mirage. No more worries. All right. So, continue to upgrade your understanding. All right, as we go to the real technology, which relocation is a part of that, you know, much, much better, higher technology effectiveness for us. Okay. Very great. That's it.